Subscribe to our YouTube channel and don't forget to press the bell icon to get all the latest updates.
Children, as we know, are so dependent on their parents. And right now, I've been talking to a lot of my cousins and my family members who are saying that in some twisted way, the pandemic has actually given them a chance to spend quality time with their family. Unfortunately, that's not the reality for a lot of children. And as we know, data shows that one out of every second child is a victim, or rather a survivor, of child sexual abuse. And NCRB also in 2018 said that the scary fact is that 95% of the perpetrators actually belong to the so-called trusted circles that these children belong to. I'm joined right now by Smita Bharti, who's the executive director of Sakshi NGO, which has been working tirelessly for increasing awareness on child sexual abuse. Smita, I would like to dive straight in by asking you a little more about the Rakshan project and who the Rakshan is.
Thank you so much, Nidhi. Thank you for inviting me and also for focusing on something which is really invisible and ignored. In fact, I was part of a webinar just half an hour ago, which was hosted by World Vision, in which they've just done a rapid assessment study and in which they have got about 10 to 11% children feeling insecure. So that's like as recent as half an hour ago that I've been made aware of these statistics. So the Rakshan project is actually an initiative that we are taking on with the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, Directorate of NSS, and they have directed us to work with the NSS students in all the college units. And don't ask me how many college units, because there's so many across the country. It's a pan-India initiative.
Almost 40,000, if I'm right.
That's right. Yeah. 40,000. We have just started in January, so we have a long way to go. Yeah. But maybe with technology, maybe not such a long way. And it is it is an initiative that they're working with the NSS students in making them aware of their constitutional right to equality. We're making them aware of what is child sexual abuse, how is it that they can actually recognize, address, identify, and de-escalate and report a situation of child sexual abuse if there is. So we are looking at Rakshans being as those who are committed to preventing harm, and in this case, child sexual abuse.
And how many Rakshans are part of the team now?
Well, we just started in January, and we had just started and we went into the field in February, actually early February, and then we had COVID in mid-March.
So the field shifted.
So we shifted from on ground onto, it took us about 2 weeks to transition into an online module place, online webinar reaching out. And since then till now, we have reached about almost 11,000 students in approximately 150 colleges in about 6 states.
And what is, as per your observation, what is the trend that, what has happened after the pandemic has taken place? You know, is there an increase in child sexual abuse at home? Because a lot more children are at home and a lot more children are vulnerable in that sense to perpetrators living with them.
Yes, absolutely. Because I'm relying primarily on the studies that have been conducted by different groups of people and organizations. And ICPF has reported that there has been a 95% spike in demand for child-based sexual material. And that in itself is a very worrying figure. If you look at it, because mostly what we're looking at is that everything is happening online right now. So children are more and more exposed to being online, maybe with parental guidance or maybe not with parental guidance, but we have not actually gone ahead and given them enough information or education about what is possible. We haven't explained grooming to them. We haven't explained boundaries to them. We haven't explained what are the possibilities that can actually happen while they are online without any safeguards or any measures. So right now we're not just looking at what can happen probably from within the family, which is what we were concerned about, or within the people that is a known and trusted circle. Right now children are vulnerable to the world.
Yeah, online sexual exploitation.
Online sexual, exactly.
Yeah. And Also, in such a topic, a lot of the times the focus becomes women and girl children being exposed to sexual exploitation. What is the rate of young boys getting affected by sexual exploitation? How do they talk about it?
So I'll answer this in two ways. I mean, we have a very, very old and a very small sample size study that is conducted by the Ministry of Women and Child as far back as 2007. It was a very small sample size, but even then it was 52% boys as opposed to 48% girls
that's,
who had
experienced. Wow, that's 2% more.
Yes, right? Now, that was very long ago, 2007, and I'm not privy to any other assessment that has been taken place since then, except for World Vision, which is also almost correlated figures that we have over here. And in my experience, in which we have this limited experience of working with almost about 11,000 students, and these are, mind you, we're not talking to children directly, we're talking to young adults, we're talking to 18 to 22-year-olds. Right, but even within that, for us, our parameter of assessment is because of the kind of questions that get asked by us, the kind of information that the youth is seeking from us, you know. And from there, it is very obvious that it is not limited to either girls or boys. Both have been in the past, and I'm assuming continue to be exposed to this kind of violence.
Yeah. And in fact, the 2019 POXO amendment, actually, there's been a lot of criticism that because of the stringent punishment, a lot of the cases reported actually will actually go unreported or expose the child to being more vulnerable. What has Rakshin done some work with regards to, or Sakshi done some work regards to POXO in that aspect?
So we believe ki badla nahi badlav chahiye. Okay. So for us, our focus is very, so law comes into play when we are reaching the abuse. We are talking about that time. How is it that you're going to create the prevention so that we do not reach that space? So we are actually really completely, the actions are focused on creating preventers. What is it that they are going to watch out for? How are they going to have this kind of a conversation in their house? It's an integral part of our program design is for the Rakshins to be not only, so when they come for our conversations and our webinars and they're in touch with us, whatever they're gaining from us, we encourage them to go and talk to at least two people in the family immediately and in an ongoing conversation. So have these difficult conversations with somebody who's older than you and with somebody who's younger than you so that you kind of spread the information. You create a norming of a conversation that we can talk about all of these things. We don't have to be quiet about it. We don't have to deny that this doesn't happen, you know. So from that perspective, I think the Rakshins are really focused on preventing child sexual abuse, penetrating, denial, silence, shame, stigma. And within the act, we're talking to them about and saying that what you really need to know is that if you know about something, you have to report it. Okay. So we're encouraging them with a very, very simple maxim that we have. Na karenge, na karne denge. Agar hua, ho raha hai, to rok denge. Aur agar hua hai, to bol ke rahenge. So we're focusing on that aspect of the act which says speak about it, right. Report it. So reporting child sexual abuse is a very, very complex issue. It's not just as simple as saying, oh, okay, I get to know about this is happening in my family and now I'm going to go out and I'm going to immediately, you know, call in the police, call in. So it's a hard road. It's not a simple road.
And I must ask you, you know, now that everything is shifting online, including awareness programs, is there a large section of society, you know, that's getting cut off from having access to even an awareness program? You know, such an awareness program now is for people who have the internet and who have an access to a laptop. What happens now to those who don't have access to the internet? Where do they get this awareness from?
Yeah, this is a question that is plaguing many of us, many groups across the country, this whole digital divide that we're talking about. And so all programs are actually looking at very innovative ways and how do they actually penetrate this big divide that is there from the haves of the digital to the have-nots of the digital access, so to speak. But some of the things that we have worked about is, okay, so So when we're talking digital, I'm also considering the phone as the halves, because people are logging in from the computers, but they're also logging in from their phones. But then it's also about the network, and it's also about Wi-Fi, and it's also about having access to the bandwidth, the broadband, so to speak. But as one of the innovative things that we have looked at within our program is about how is it that the person who's we are reaching out to actually becomes the message carrier. So the message receiver becomes the message carrier for their immediate community and beyond. So we are encouraging them to, so keeping COVID conditions in mind, keeping all the protocols that need to be kept in mind. Within that, how is it that you can actually, and we have a completely structured program in which we encourage them to take it not only to within their family, but also to their peer group, and also reaching out to a larger community, whether it is the rural community or it is the slum cluster community that we're talking about. But all of us are really struggling with this divide.
And the other thing, I mean, the last thing I do want to touch upon is, you know, sex education or bringing sex education to school has been such a long battle. And even now we're still trying to have that conversation in school. And the reason why it has been brought to school is probably because, you know, the conversation is not happening at home. And now the child doesn't have a space to go to that is the school and doesn't even have access to whatever little sexual awareness that was coming from schools or whatever quality it was. So according to you, what is the conversation that parents should be having with children right now? How do they address it?
It starts very simply, Nidhi. It starts with just owning the language, you know. It just starts with being able to speak about the autonomy of your body. The owning of your body and owning of your body parts, you know, it starts very simply by just removing the aspect of shame.
Right.
Because we have so much shame associated with anything which has sex in it.
Yeah, I mean, as a child, when you take your clothes off, you sing the song "Shame, Shame, Puppy Shame," and that's what you're taught as a child.
Absolutely, yeah. And we call a vagina "Shame, Shame."
Yeah.
We would not kind of give it a name, and there is a stigma attached to it. If you have that language, then you are not a good person, you know. So the first thing that really needs to start is, how do I own my language? How do I encourage children to understand what is the autonomy of the body? How do I encourage the children to understand what is the boundary of my body? How do I encourage children to be having a language where they can talk about whatever is happening with them without feeling a sense of shame or secrecy, or, you know, because this is exactly what happens in grooming, because then the person builds upon this whole act of secrecy and conspiracy and says, if you tell somebody, then you will be known as a bad person. So keep quiet about it. Don't talk about it. But just giving the children the language and removing this whole conspiracy of silence and secrecy from it is absolutely the first step that needs to happen at home or in schools. And this is exactly what we're doing. And even though we're working with...
Is there an age that this starts at? Like, is there an age that you have to start having this conversation from? Or you suggest it's a lifestyle practice?
So let me just ask you a question. What was the age when you learned that this is a forehead or these are eyes?
I see what you mean. Yeah, as a child, you know. You pointed it out as a child, yeah.
This needs to start as simply and as early as that. Yeah. And then build upon, just as you would talk about an emotion like anger, you would continue to talk about other situations as well. Why do we have to create a distinction or a discrimination between these are things that we can talk about and these are things that we must not talk about, or we should keep quiet, or we should only talk in a small huddle about it? Because if we have an open conversation about it, then it is not a good thing. So as soon as we remove the shame and secrecy from it, or, you know, give it so much charge, we remove that charge, things are going to feel very normal. And then, and coupled with that, if I'm also encouraging the children to understand what is my personal boundary, what is my personal autonomy, my body autonomy, in that point of time, it's so easy for me to understand consent.
Right.
You know, it's so easy for me to understand invasion. It's so easy for me to understand what is violation. That sense, I'm giving you a sense of self from the word go. Crowding secrecy or silence.
All right, Smita, kudos to your team and the effort. And I really hope that a lot of parents are having this conversation. I think there's a perception that, you know, sexual abuse or rape in India happens in rural heartlands, but that, as we know, is definitely not true. And And it happens very much in urban spaces. And I really, really hope that parents have this conversation with children. And thank you to you for taking the time out to join us.
Thank you so much, Nidhi. Thank you. A pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.